act to rebuke the skeptics. Restoring faith in New York, where the Yankees rally round relief and retaliate repeatedly against all opponents to revitalize their supporters. Rejuvenated Redbirds respond to their critics, reclaiming their position at the top with a rebuttal that reverberates throughout the Shea Stadium. Give and take, stroke and counterstroke. That's the reply from the pros when asked what it takes to reciprocate at the plate. So remain where you are, because we'll return for it all on This Week in Baseball. Celebrating our 10th anniversary. This Week in Baseball is brought to you by Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade is thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Right now, your body's thirsty for more than water.
You got your one and only body like you never have before.
Quench its Gatorade is thirst aid.
So go and give your thirsty body what it's feeling thirsty for.
Quench its Gatorade is thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Gatorade Thirst Quencher quenches the thirst in your throat while it helps put back the potassium, fluids, and minerals your whole body's thirsty for.
Quench its Gatorade is thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Winning, it's easy. Give 110%, expect 110%. From yourself, everyone, everything. Speed Stick deodorant gives 110%. That's its edge. Why? It has no alcohol, and alcohol evaporates. Speed Stick protection doesn't evaporate even after 24 hours. Glides on in just a few strokes. That's 110% protection.
Speed Stick deodorant, the wide stick.
That's your edge.
By Menon.
Just look at this store full of shoe bargains. Hi, I'm Oney of Oney's Family Shoes in Owensboro. We are quitting business at the Carter Road store only. The Sherm Road store will still continue to serve you. We have thousands of pairs of name brand shoes at low quitting business prices. Save big on our huge selection of shoes for the entire family. Every pair is quitting business price. That's Oney's Family Shoes, quitting business sale at 1230 Carter Road.
Now, the home gym that treats your body to a nine-station workout. TrimTrack. Durable, no-nonsense construction. Yet TrimTrack can be yours on this special TV offer for just $29.95. It's a rowing machine. Perfect exercise for flattening the tummy. And you'll love quality touches like the padded seat and smooth as silk track action. The padded footlock is perfect for sit-ups. Gives you a trim, tight waistline. Hop on your knees for arm curls. Does miracles for arms and neck and chin. Trim Track. It's the fast track to the slender, younger figure you've been dreaming of. Just $29.95. Have your credit card ready and call now. Here's how to order.
Thousands sold at $39.95. Now only $29.95. Call 1-800-228-5509. Or send $29.95 plus $5 shipping and handling to Trim Track. Box 2728, Evansville, Indiana.
American League Review. In New York, the Yankees put a lid on the Brewers. Yankee fans are mighty hungry for a division crown, and the team showed signs of satisfying that appetite by running off of the three-game sweep of the Milwaukee Brewers. In the opener, Mike Pagliarulo was given the green light to swing at a 3-0 pitch, and Pags parked it downtown for a two-run homer that stood up as the game winner. It was a chilly night in the Big Apple, and rookie Bob Tewksbury kept the Brewers on ice by going 7 1/3 innings and collecting a win in his major league debut. Southpaw Rod Scurry was called on to keep the chill on Milwaukee, and he tossed an inning and 2/3 of perfect relief to pick up the save as New York won it 3-2. Next day, skipper Lou Piniella celebrated his wedding anniversary, and Butch Weininger put on a party at the plate by blasting his second 3-run homer this season. Both were game winners. By the way, Butch hit just 5 homers all last year. The Yankees just kept on soaring in the final game, thanks in large part to a banner day with a bat by premier New York hitman Don Mattingly, who got his first game winner of the season by launching a rocket to the wall that drove home 2 runs. Looking pretty as a picture on the mound was left-hander Ron Guidry, who got his second win, giving him a record of 15-2 at home over the past two seasons. But the Yankees needed help to close out the victory, and they got it from Dave Righetti, who struck out the side in the ninth inning for his second save of the series and third of the season, while New York made its point by jumping off to a 6-1 start, best in the league. Now, let's focus on a courageous comeback effort that paid off royally. When 34-year-old Dennis Leonard took the mound for Kansas City in a game against Toronto, it marked his first start since the spring of 83. And after 3 years, four operations, and countless hours of rehabilitation, the three-time 20-game winner made a most triumphant return.
There it is! What a truly beautiful moment at Royal Stadium. A 1-0 complete game, three-hit shutout for a man whose career appeared to be over several times.
I'm a very determined person. You know, when I went through a lot of these operations, a lot of people said I'd never be able to pitch again. And, you know, I felt, well, I like to prove people wrong. When people say I can't, I'm going to try it.
Against Baltimore on May 28, 1983, Leonard suffered a devastating knee injury from which few athletes ever recover. But he battled back bravely, making his first appearance since the injury in a short relief assignment against Milwaukee at the end of last season.
It was really exciting for me that first outing. You know, it was a game that we were ahead by a lot of runs. It was just one inning, but, you know, the fans in Kansas City gave me a, you know, tremendous ovation, and, you know, it made everything that I've done as far as the rehab, going through the operations, feel like was well worth it.
California's Rick Burleson feels the same way, because he's back at shortstop after his three-year absence forced by injury. 34-year-old Burleson had not started in the field since the end of 83. He first injured his shoulder trying to complete a double play against the Twins in 82.
During my first 8 years of my career, I was never hurt. I was an everyday player, and I felt that part of my value as a player was to be able to go out and play every day, whether I could help defensively or offensively. Just being in the lineup, I could help the team some way.
Joe Sambito is now helping the Red Sox. Against Detroit in Boston's third game of the season, 33-year-old Sambito picked up his first save since 1982, when he was one of the game's top relievers with Houston before suffering a career-threatening elbow injury against St. Louis in his last save. Three examples of never-say-die determination. Boston's Joe Sambito, California's Rick Burleson, and Kansas City's Dennis Leonard. Welcome back to action, men. Now let's open the notebook for this week in baseball's TWIB notes from around the American League. Seattle rookie Danny Tartable is off to some kind of start. Get this, a home run in four straight games, and overall in the Mariners' first eight games, a batting average above 350, nine runs scored, and 14 RBIs. The 23-year-old second baseman is the son of former major leaguer Jose Tartable. Andy Allenson of Cleveland is another rookie who's making a big hit. The 24-year-old catcher had 10 base hits in his first 22 major league at-bats. Indians manager Pat Corrales has to be pleased with his entire team's production at the plate, averaging more than four runs and eight hits per outing through the first seven games. And now it's time for this week's quiz, brought to you by Nissan, builders of high-quality cars and trucks for over 50 years. It wasn't the best of performances by Milwaukee Brewer pitcher Jaime Kochenour. In a loss to the Yankees, the second-year right-hander went seven innings, but walked nine batters, a new team record. Now, for this week's quiz, can you name the pitcher who holds the all-time mark for most bases on balls issued in a career? Stay tuned for a still active fireballer.
Before you settle for basic transportation, how'd you like to own a car like this? Fuel injected. Overhead cam. Five speed. Four-wheel independent suspension. This is the all-new 1987 Nissan Sentra Sport Coupe. Bye-bye, basics. Hello, Sentra. The name is Nissan.
Lyle Alcedo just got tough.
Because I started using Tegrin medicated shampoo and stopped using Head & Shoulders. No more pretty shampoo for me. Tegrin's tough. Four times tough. It's got a special ingredient that tackles not only your everyday dandruff, but all four major causes of flaking and itching. Tegrin does more than Head & Shoulders ever could. So for a man's...
And a woman's.
Tough defense against dandruff. Get four times tough with Tegrin medicated shampoo.
I know who you belong to, from the way that he holds you.
Hi, this is T.G. Shepherd. There's lots of good music just waiting for you somewhere down the line. This train will be pulling out at the same time, same station, and will be loaded with some special passengers. The soulful Mr. Razzie Bailey, the delightful new talent of Miss Kelly Lang. Climb on board. We're pulling out for the new Music City, USA.
Sunday at 5 on TV 44.
I'm Temple Wolf, and I'm going to huff and puff and give you a great buy on your next car or truck. For professional sales and friendly service, come to Temple Wolf Ford Lincoln Mercury in Henderson.
Mom and Dad have it all together.
We're geezers.
Alex has a new attitude.
I'm a contemporary guy.
Mallory knows her mind.
I don't want to change any diapers.
And Jennifer's getting a grip.
Am I on candid camera?
Nothing stronger than family ties.
Weekdays at 11:30 on 44.
National League scene. In New York, the Cards brought back memories of last year. After spending the first week of the season on the road, Davey Johnson's Mets opened at home against St. Louis, their nemesis in 1985. Met fans were feeling mighty fine because Dwight Gooden was on the mound and going good, striking out six and allowing just five hits. But his lofty pitching was wasted because the Mets scored only one run before Gooden departed after eight innings. As usual, Whitey Herzog's outstanding defense helped keep the Cardinals in the game. Gooden was long gone by the top of the 13th, scored tied at two, when Met third baseman Howard Johnson committed a critical error with the bases loaded, allowing the Cardinals their first two runs in a four-run inning. It was left to rookie Pat Perry to finish off the Mets and pick up the win, as St. Louis spoiled New York's home opener and raced off to a 5-1 start, best in the league. Speed on the base paths was a big reason why St. Louis went to the World Series last year. And with a Major League leading 16 team steals for their first six games, the running Redbirds gave notice that they have no intention of slowing down. Next stop, Los Angeles, where the Giants stood tall against the Dodgers. New San Francisco manager Roger Craig has instilled an upbeat spirit on the team, and just maybe a killer instinct as well.
We were like little kids without discipline the last couple of years, and that situation has changed dramatically. Roger's in charge, and he has been since day one. I think that's the biggest difference. We have leadership, and now you see guys really, really busting their tails, and I'm sure it'll carry on through the season.
We're eliminating a lot of negative stuff. I've always been a very positive person. I'm dumb enough to think I can do anything, and I think it's kind of rubbed off. I always set goals for myself. This is one of my motivation theories, is that for pitchers, if a guy's going to start 40 games, you know, there's no reason why he shouldn't win 20. If a guy's going to go to bat 600 times, no reason why he shouldn't hit 300. My goal is to have the best ball club that I can have on the field that given day against whoever we're playing, and then try to do everything I possibly can to win that ball game.
Jeff Robinson did plenty to help beat the Dodgers in game one, striking out six in 2 2/3 innings of relief and getting the win. The score was tied at 8-8 when Brad Goulden came to bat in the top of the 12th, and he promptly delivered the game-winning RBI. Dodger skipper Tommy Lasorda could barely bring himself to watch when Jeff Leonard batted. After cracking a three-run homer in the opener, Leonard unloaded another long ball the next night, and it proved to be the game winner in San Francisco's second straight extra inning victory. Greg Minton got the win in relief, and although the Dodgers took game three, early indications are that the Giants are on the way back.
We have a very positive attitude. The players have had a tough spring training, but they seem to like it, seem to felt that they feel that they need it, and I think we're going to see a lot of good results from it.
Now, let's review this week in baseball's TWIB notes from around the National League. When Pedro Guerrero went down with an injury, Franklin Stubbs took his place as the starting left fielder for Los Angeles, and Franklin's filling in mighty fine. Three home runs and nine RBIs in the three-game span for the 25-year-old Stubbs, who was about to be sent down to the minors before Guerrero tore up his knee just 4 days before the start of the season. New Padre Marvell Wynn is paying big dividends for Steve Burrows. In the seventh inning of the game against Cincinnati, Wynn hammered a pinch-hit homer, then batted again in the bottom of the ninth with a score tied.
It's hit deep. San Diego is going to win it on a home run by Marvell Wynn. What an afternoon for the former Pittsburgh Pirate.
Next night against Los Angeles, the Padres pulled out another one. Rookie John Kruk came up with a man on in the bottom of the 10th and singled to tie the game. The first big league hit for 25-year-old Kruk. An inning later, Bruce Bochy hit a solo homer to win it. And both San Diego and L.A. went on to set a big league record by starting the season with 10 straight games, all decided by one run. Second baseman Johnny Ray has helped Pittsburgh get off to a better start than anticipated. He batted 500 through the first five games and collected nine RBIs, including two consecutive game winners, as the Pirates won three in a row after losing their first two games of the season. Now let's move on to the answer of this week's Nissan quiz. Houston's Nolan Ryan holds the all-time record for walks issued. At the start of this year, Ryan had walked 2,186 batters through 19 seasons. Of course, he's also the all-time strikeout leader with 4,083 going into this year. By the way, the modern-day record for most walks in a season was set by Cleveland Hall of Famer Bob Feller in 1938. 208 in 278 innings.
Today's small cars are tougher than ever on oil. Their high-compression engines not only rev high, they can run hotter than regular small car engines. Their searing heat can begin to break down an oil immediately. That's why there's Castrol, the only leading motor oil that in every grade provides maximum protection against viscosity and thermal breakdown. So use Castrol before your engine does something to get you heated up. Castrol, engineered for today's smaller cars.
Me and my partner always agree. That's why we're both here to tell you about a big truckload sale going on now at Curtis Mathis. And one of the bargains is this 19-inch monitor receiver for just $6.99. It comes with its own stand and his and her remote controls. So trot on into Curtis Mathis and pick up a monitor receiver so you and your little filly can watch those old westerns.
Cartoon.
Western.
Curtis
Mathis. Get
Evansville
and Owensboro.
Western.
Over here in Cleveland, baby, I'll spill a pack. Well, honey, it ain't your money, cause baby, I got plenty of hack. I'll look at your bank.
Danny DeVito and Joe Piscopo are low-ranking mobsters in the new comedy Wise Guys. One of four new movies we'll review this week at the movies, the Movie Review Program.
The U.S. Army is at war with Private Benjamin.
There's no reason why we couldn't get up at 9:30 or 10.
Now you're up!
Have a little brunch and then go shoot our guns or whatever.
We use the trigger. Nothing can go wrong.
Neither side will surrender. And it's a battle to the finish with Private Benjamin. Weeknights at 6 on TV 44.
Hey, fans, let's get on the ball with a look at how some of baseball's master blasters do their thing. Behold the baseball bat. In no other sport does the proper use of one piece of equipment consume so much time, thought, and effort, because there's simply no sporting endeavor more difficult than hitting. Boston's Wade Boggs gets hits in bunches. His 240 last season were the most in 55 years. And with help from Red Sox hitting coach Walt Reniac, he's won two of the last three league batting crowns and sports a .351 career average.
The thing that I try to get all hitters to do is to learn what I call a discipline of the head. And by learning the ability to what I call lower the head on the baseball and keep the head down and still on the ball, it allows you to track the ball a little bit longer, hit it more often, and get more hits. Wade Boggs, in my opinion, the greatest hitter in the last 50 years as far as getting a base hit. He has a real good weight shift. By that, I mean he gets back before he goes forward, and he does that with a front leg cock. His front leg has to have a cock in it where he can go back before he goes forward. The other thing about Boggs is that he has a tremendous discipline of the strike zone. He can take one strike, he can take two strikes, and then he can go to work on the pitcher. What we have here in Boston is the greatest hitter that I've ever seen.
Hall of Famer Ted Williams most often gets that accolade. The former Red Soxer hit .344 over 19 seasons and developed his own science of hitting.
The very first move you should make is one that has been ignored, the cocking of the hip. It's the root of batting power, and it comes in unison with the beginning of the stride. The lead knee turns in to allow the hips and shoulders to rotate. The hands go back in cocking position. My lead foot strides toward the pitcher.
A lot of people say to swing level, which isn't too bad. Others say to swing down at the ball, which I think is real bad. But to me, the ideal swing has always been one that was slightly up, slightly up. If you swing in the opposite plane in which the ball is being pitched from, that your chances of making contact are much greater.
The Science of Hitting by Ted Williams. I read it when I was a senior in high school. Big thing that I got out of his book was patience and discipline, learning the strike zone and knowing what pitches you can hit and what pitches you can't.
Of course, that's easier said than done. But let's hear it from some other top flight hitters on what they try to do to be successful at the plate, beginning with 309 career hitter Bill Madlock.
It is the hardest thing in sports. I think it's the hardest thing to explain in sports, too, because you're looking at something that's only take a fraction of a second to do, about time it leaves the pitcher's hand, about time it get up onto you. But one base velocity that I try to keep is, we call it Willie Starch. I talked to him about it, is slow feet and quick hands. When you see the ball coming out the pitcher's hand, you put your feet out there slow, and then when you see your ball coming to the strike zone, you got to bring your hands to the strike zone in a hurry.
I literally stay back, not move my body until I see the ball. And when I see the ball as quickly as I can and then react to that ball, I basically let my natural ability do what has to be done.
You have to get your weight back, and what I'm saying is when the pitcher rears back to throw, you got to be rearing back to hit. And it's like going back and then clashing together when the ball meets there. When you get it back, you have to stay back long enough so that you can see the fastball, so you can see the curveball, the off-speed pitch, and then make your mind up whether you're going to hit it, and then therefore you have to have it all distributed going the other way.
I had trouble getting around on fastball, so I dropped from a 34 to a 32, and I started hitting the ball more consistently. And I, you know, as a hitter, you want to go up there and at least put the bat on the ball. You want to put the ball in play and make the defense get you out. And I found success using it, and I've stuck with it so far.
It seems like when you're swinging the bat good, it's the easiest thing in the world, but when you're swinging the bat bad, or in a slump, it's the most difficult thing in the world. I go up there and look for the ball, and if my fundamentals are good, I'm going to hit the ball, and I'm going to hit it hard somewhere. If the ball's away, and my fundamentals are good, I'm going to hit a line drive or a fly ball to deep left. If the ball's inside, I'm going to have just a quick swing, and I'm going to pull the ball. If the ball's down the middle, I'm going to either hit the left center, right center, or hit the ball up the middle. I've been successful doing that, and that's why I do it.
Well, nobody does it better than New York Yankee Don Mattingly, last year's American League MVP, on the strength of 35 homers, 145 RBIs, and a .324 batting average. But however it's done, and whoever is doing it, one thing is absolutely certain. The quest for that perfect swing will never end. Now, it's this week in baseball's 10th anniversary flashback. brought to you by Gatorade. Let's flash back to 1981. The scene was Yankee Stadium. Pitching for New York was reliever Dave LaRoche, and batting for Milwaukee was Gorman Thomas. And their battle is now known simply as La Lob.
It was a situation, I remember, I think there were runners at second and third, and Bob Lemon had just become the manager. He came out to the mound wanting to know if I wanted to put Gorman on or what we wanted to do. And I said, well, how about if I just throw in my curveball? And Lem hadn't seen it yet. He didn't know what my curveball was, my lob.
Neither did Thomas, or for that matter, just about everybody else. But they soon found out, because this not-so-classic confrontation ended with a strikeout. LaRoche was on the verge of laughter, but Gorman was storming.
What I was really trying to do was trying to hit a home run, because we had blown the Yankees out in that game, and they brought in Dave, and I really didn't know what was going on, because he had two strikes on me, and then here comes the first one. I said, oh, Christ's sake, what is this? And I'd only played one game of slow pitch softball in my life, so I really wasn't sure the proper technique of hitting it.
You know, I threw two or three, and he fouled one off, and then he tried, I think he tried to bunt one, and I tried to sneak a fastball, and everyone was kind of having a good time. I think Gorman was, he was a great sport about it, too, because he was having a good time, and it perturbed him a little bit, maybe.
I guess there was about 20,000 people in Yankee Stadium, and they were hooting on me pretty good, so I tossed the helmet up and slow pitched it up in the air, and I smoked it. Just shattered it.
But Thomas got a chance for revenge one year later, in 1982, again at Yankee Stadium. This time, when LaRoche lofted up La Lob, Thomas connected for La Single to left field. But hey, it sure didn't come easy.
Well, the second time, I kind of gave him a little smile, and I was thinking to myself, being a fair sport, I thought I would give him another chance. So this time, I think I threw him 8 or 10 straight, and he was fouling them off and pulling them way up in the upper deck. And I mean, the softer I was throwing it, the harder he'd swing.
Finally, I buried one in the left field and got a line drive and got on first base, and a bunch of the Yankees would give me a lot of crap. And more or less tipped my hat and stuck my tongue out, and you know, it was even.
A fitting way to end La Story. But that's all for now, folks. See you next week on This Week in Baseball.
What's this, tough guy?
Aftershave skin conditioner.
I know. I thought I was the only guy with sensitive skin.
Every time I shave, I get it right here.
What do you fellas use? Because shaving irritates my whole face.
After.
Try it. Looks different.
It's rich. It's a lotion. After soothes razor scrape sensitive skin.
Hey, this feels great. And smells good, too. Terrific.
Sensible care for sensitive skin. Aftershave skin conditioner.
By Menon.
Season TV 44 brings you exciting St. Louis Cardinals baseball as the defending National League
tragically grounding this oh-so-sweet bird of youth. A Boston pitching pilot elevates the game with blast-off after blast-off, ascending to historic heights and hovering over all the rest. The Redbirds were looking to relaunch, but instead the Mets took off, streaking like a rocket and increasing their lofty altitude above the flock. Zooming back in time, a swooping hit is stopped in midair and lands in a leather nest to leave the batter flapping in the breeze. So get ready to rise up for it all on This Week in Baseball. celebrating our 10th anniversary. This Week in Baseball is brought to you by Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade is thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Right now, your body's thirsty for more than water.
You want your one and only body like you never had before.
Which it's Gatorade, it's thirst aid.
So go and give your thirsty body what it's feeling thirsty for.
Which it's Gatorade, it's thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Gatorade Thirst Quencher quenches the thirst in your throat while it helps put back the potassium, fluids, and minerals your whole body's thirsty for.
Quench it, Gatorade is thirsty for that deep down body thirst.
Power. I want it here. I want it in my antiperspirant.
Speed Stick has the most powerful wetness fighter you can buy. Nothing fights wetness better.
The Wide Stick.
The most powerful you can buy. Speed Stick antiperspirant.
By Nandan.
Skin Bracer Aftershave has what it takes to cool, soothe, tone, tighten, and to wake up your face.
Thanks. I needed that.
After every shave, it has what your face needs. Skin Bracer.
This is the Curtis Mathis camcorder, the best value anywhere.
Yep.
The only camcorder with an exclusive 4-year limited warranty on parts and labor. Plus, look at everything you'll receive free when you purchase a Curtis Mathis camcorder during May. Or check out the low sale price on this portable VCR and lightweight camera. Special financing available to qualified buyers so you can make today's special occasion a special memory for years to come. That's Curtis Mathis in Evansville and Owensboro. But hurry before those babies grow up.
To these cowboys.
Do you know me? Most people don't unless I'm with my friend here, Marvin. That's why I carry this. It's the American Red Cross blood donor card. It means I've donated life-giving blood to the Red Cross. And in case of an emergency, medical crews will know who I am and what my blood type is. Donating blood is an investment in you and your family's future. 20 tri-state hospitals depend on our support daily. The Red Cross Blood Donor Card. Don't go anywhere without it.
Major League drama. Making history on the mound, Boston's Roger Clemens.
And here they come up at Fenway. Strikeouts in a game. 20.
Only 23 years old, and in just his second full season in the majors, Clemens broke the old record of 19 strikeouts in a 9-inning game, shared by pitching greats Tom Seaver, Steve Carlton, and Nolan Ryan. Clemens also tied an American League record with 8 strikeouts in a row, 2 short of Seaver's 10 when with the Mets. No walks in the win over Seattle as Clemens raised his record to 4-0. Congratulations, Roger, and welcome to the record book. National League showdown. In St. Louis, the Mets shuffle the cards. The defending National League champions were all smiles until the no-nonsense New York Mets came to town and sent St. Louis into a tailspin. Howard Johnson spun a surprise in Game 1, batting in the 9th inning with a man on, the cards up by 2.
Mets need a long ball. They might have it. This ball is out of here, and this game is tied. Oh, my goodness. So much for fate.
Fate belonged to New York on this night because in the top of the 10th inning, George Foster was looking for his first game-winning hit this season, and he got it, breaking a streak of 90 straight regular season wins by the Cardinals in games in which they led in the 9th inning. The Mets popped off the plate again in Game 2, pounding out 13 hits and scoring 9 runs. The man who really roughed up the Redbirds in Game 2 was red-hot Ray Knight. But this was Knight's night. He hit only 6 homers all last year. His 2 homers in this game gave him a total of 6 already this season, tied for the league lead. Spooking St. Louis on the mound was the heavenly Dwight Gooden, who shot down the Cardinals by going all the way on a 5-hit shutout for win number 3 without a loss. He got number 4 next time out and kept his ERA below 1.3. In Game 3, the frustrated Cardinals could barely work up a sweat because 23-year-old Sid Fernandez had him on ice, allowing just two hits and striking out 10 over eight innings to get the win and go 2-0. Things kept bouncing right for the Mets in Game 4. Rookie Kevin Mitchell hammered his first Major League home run, and that contributed to the first loss at Busch Stadium after 18 straight victories by John Tudor. Also his first regular season loss overall after 14 consecutive wins. Tudor's former Boston teammate Bob Ojeda went all the way for a 3-0 mark as first place New York swept the series and won 11 straight games overall while St. Louis was losing 7 straight. Next stop, Houston, where the Astros ignited against Cincinnati. Houston skipper Hal Lanier had to like the look of his pitching, which handled Cincinnati with ease after the Reds won the opener. In Game 2, Nolan Ryan took charge, going the distance with a five-hitter for his third win. At age 39, the Ryan Express is still rolling. Next day, the Astrodome ovation went out for Mike Scott, who fired a four-hit shutout for the second of his three wins this year. Houston's only score came courtesy of pinch runner Billy Hatcher, who stole second on a pass ball pitch out in the bottom of the ninth. Hatcher was then sacrificed to third to set the stage for an even more costly pass ball by Reds catcher Bo Diaz.
The ball bounces away. Here comes
And they did it again in Game 4 when Cincinnati's bats were tamed by Bob Knepper, who tossed a four-hit shutout of his own to go 4-0. By taking control on the mound, Houston also took control of first place in the West.
They're pitching great, and they're carrying us. You know, we're not swinging the bats that well, and if we hadn't been getting the good pitching, you could almost reverse our record.
Now, let's open the notebook for this week in baseball's Twib Notes from around the majors. Cleveland's Pat Tabler loads up at the plate when the bases are loaded. Tabler helped beat the Yankees with a bases loaded double, and that gave him a career 6.22 average when batting the men on every base. A lifetime 276 hitter, Tabler was 23 for 36 with the bases full, good for 56 RBI. How about that? Minnesota leadoff hitter Kirby Puckett is producing with surprising power, batting near 400 with 16 RBIs and a major league leading 8 home runs. His career home run total before this year, just 4. And now it's time for this week's quiz, brought to you by Nissan, builders of high quality cars and trucks for over 50 years. Oakland's Jose Rijo has something in common with record breaker Roger Clemens, 30 strikeouts over 2 straight starts. Rijo struck out 14 Seattle batters after setting down 16 Mariners in his previous start. But for this week's quiz, can you name the 3 pitchers who share the record of 32 strikeouts over 2 straight starts? Stay tuned.
It's time you said bye-bye, Basics.
Hello, Sentra.
The all-new Nissan Sentra 487 is much more than basic transportation. It's newly designed with a longer wheelbase, smoother ride, and superior handling. So say bye-bye, Basics. Who made their most affordable car even better? The name is Nissan, America's number one selling import car.
Today's small cars are tougher than ever on oil. Their high-compression engines not only rev high, they can run hotter than regular small car engines. Their searing heat can begin to break down an oil immediately. That's why there's Castrol, the only leading motor oil that in every grade provides maximum protection against viscosity and thermal breakdown. So use Castrol before your engine does something to get you heated up. Castrol, engineered for today's smaller cars.
Hey, partner, I see you just got a brand new Curtis Mathis stereo.
Yep.
Well, did you know that for only $19.95 a week, you can rent any 2 Curtis Mathis products, TV, VCR, or stereo, and no credit check?
Yep.
And did you know that Curtis Mathis gives you free delivery and installation?
Yep.
Well, then why didn't you just rent a Curtis Mathis?
I did.
Call or visit Curtis Mathis in Evansville or Owensboro and rent your very own TV, stereo, or VCR today.
I'm sorry. The float's caused problems with the lines. I'll try another routing.
When there's trouble far away, there's someone who can help.
Ma'am, I've got him on the line.
Someone who can be reached instantly if there's an emergency.
Tommy, listen to me. I want you to get out of that house
right now, quickly. I'll call the fire department.
Someone who wants to help. Your telephone operator. For a free booklet on emergency phone tips, write Emergency Communications Workers of America, Box 13008, Washington, D.C.
Fans, let's get on the ball with a bird's-eye view of a bittersweet story. It was 10 years ago this season that Mark Fittrich blew into the big leagues like a breath of fresh air. As a 21-year-old Detroit rookie, quickly nicknamed the Bird, Fittrich was a free-spirited sensation who won 19 games while capturing the hearts and minds of baseball fans everywhere. But today, he pitches hay instead of baseballs, farming 121 acres in Northborough, Massachusetts. His career ended by injury. Just 31, he still dreams about baseball, but with the perspective of a realist.
You do have flashbacks, and you actually get into the game, but not cheering, just watching and saying, geez, if I was still out there today, you know, it'd be beautiful. But you're not, so you got to drop it and start your other life. That's the thing. Once you get out of the game, you can look back, have fun looking back, read your scrapbook, but you can't live on that. You got to live on what is today and not what was yesterday.
For Fittrich, yesterday was every boy's fantasy. Immediate stardom that came about in part because of some quirky and colorful habits on the mound.
I was doing that was because the other pitcher would make a big hole right in front of the mound, and then after he stepped off, down in front too. So you fill it in because you want to make your own hole. You don't want to get into his groove. That's what my dad always taught me. A lot of the writers wrote things that really, like I was talking to the ball. I wasn't talking about it, I was talking to myself, but yet the ball might have just been in my hand at the time. And like if I let a pitch go off here, I wanted it here. I just tell myself, so next time, you'd put it right there. And that's just the way I could control myself. It's like a batter, you know. He'll take the thing and go, okay, I swung down there. I should have swung more like that. So then he swings like that because you're training your brain. That's what it is, because you want your body to function something different.
The Bird's body functioned like nobody else's, all arms and legs in perpetual motion. He played the game with unbridled enthusiasm and displayed a pure innocence that made him an instant fan favorite.
If you were a band or something, you could start playing again, but all the other guys are saying, hey, I'm tired, we're not going to go out and play another couple innings, you know, just joking. And like I used to say, come on, guys, you guys come out with me, because this is hard for me to do. But the people, I really don't know how or why they actually, you know, like me. Maybe because we had feedback, we had vibrations, like, you know, after the game, you know, hey, how you doing? And then, you know, give autographs all the time. It seems like I owe the people a lot, because you got to remember, when you're playing the game and they're cheering you, it makes you play a little bit better. To me, it was beautiful.
But the beauty vanished abruptly. In spring training of 77, he suffered the first in a series of injuries that would end his career.
Rusty Staub and I stand out in right field. Poor Rusty goes like this to me. He says, Mark, relax, man. He says, you're having a great spring training. He goes, you got a week left. He says, slow down, man. He says, let's, you know, just shag. You don't have to go and run to left field. You know, run to center field. Just relax and sit here. And all of a sudden, no sooner did he finish his speech to me, ball gets hit out to me, right? Well, I hit out to him because he's playing right field. And I'm going like this, hey, Rusty, you want it? He says, no, you can have it, kid. I ran off after it. Played the old high school days, dove for it, right? Came down, when I dove, I went like that. When I came, I went just like that. My knee gave out, and I went, oh, dang. I looked around, there's Ralph talking to someone. I go, look for the trainer. He's over there playing with another ball player, right? I'm going, good. I get up to Rusty, and I get the side of Rusty. And I'm going, ah, phew. Because I caught that one pretty good, huh? High school days. He goes, forget that, Mark. What'd you do to your knee? And I went, I don't know, Rusty. It's going inside. He goes, he hits me right in the back of the head and goes, what did I just tell you? No more than a minute ago. He says, and there you are. I mean, he says, go see the trainer. I said, nah, Rusty, I mean, let me, you know, work it out a little bit. Maybe it's just, you know, a little hyperextension. You know, it might not be nothing drastic. Then all of a sudden, I'm running around. I'm going, I think it's drastic. I mean, I can actually feel it going, boom, you know, swelling up. So I went and saw him. College, I blew the college out, man. Rusty never lets me forget about it. He says, you know, if you only listen to me. I said, well, just look at it this way, Rusty. If you went after the ball like you were supposed to because you're the right fielder, that would have never happened. You know, reversed it on me. He goes, oh, you know, it was unbelievable. But that's where it all started, right there. Because they said when I was throwing and when I land the leg, I was landing it like this instead of straight on. So when I landed it like this, I opened up like that, you know, and I did it. It was unnatural. I mean, I felt comfortable. I didn't know it. So we pulled some films from here to nowadays, and you could see it. The minute I came around, instead of coming straight like that, I'd go boom, and I'd open up, and it just took all the stress on here. And so, I mean, it only lasted so long, and then finally that's when the arm just went, and then finally, I you know, we just all looked at each other and said, hey, I think my arm's hurt. You know, I'm not sure, but I mean, I can't do nothing with it anymore. I mean, it's actually, to get it up to throw, to play catch, I had to, you know, to throw it, because I was always in pain. But if I was smart, but see, I was so young at the time that I was afraid to say, you know, I think I'm hurt. And I don't blame it on anyone but myself, because I could have been the man and said, hey, I'm hurt. I don't care what you guys say. I don't care, you know, what the press say. It's my body. I'm not dying for you people, you know. But yet I went and died.
But Fidrich went down fighting. He spent most of the next 4 years in the minors trying to recover, periodically returning to the majors only to be disabled again. And yet he always kept a sense of humor.
Sitting on the bench and I'm just watching everyone, and like everyone knows, I used to always be loud, you know, and I'm just sitting there observing. One day went by, the second day I'm observing, and then the third day, and you know, I'm just getting my feet wet. I had a pitch like 2 days from now, and all of a sudden I just, hey, come on, bat. You know, Brian Dedman just looks down, hey, it's about time he started talking. We always heard about you like that, you know. Everyone on the bench started laughing. I'm going, hey, he said, you know, whoa, Jesus, he does talk. And then a week goes by, right? You know, I'm still going, all of a sudden, Brian Dedman, Jesus, you haven't shut up yet since the other day. You know, and it's just, everyone cracked up again. I'm going, oh, wow.
He spent two more years in Boston's minor league system, still trying to come back. But finally, in June of 83, the bird faced harsh reality.
I know the writing's on the wall, man. I can look myself in the mirror and say, you know, you don't have it right now. So I get down there. He's sitting in the chair, and I'm just standing there. He goes, Mark, I don't know how to do this. I said, you don't have to do nothing. I said, I know I'm gone. I said, he goes, well, what do you want to do? You want to get released? I said, no, I want to retire. I got released from the Tigers. I'm going to retire this time. It's a different word. And he said, boy, you're taking it. I said, hey, I've seen it coming. You know, I mean, I'm not stupid. I've been hurt for the last 6 years. I'm lucky I hung on this long. And, you know, he says, you know, this is hard for a manager. And I'm going, yeah, I know how hard it is for a manager to release a guy. You know, but I'm retiring, so you don't have to release me. And he said, I said, nah. I said, I think it's time the kid's out of the game.
The game's great loss, but the fans still remember his shining season of 76, even though Fidrich is now far removed from the ball field.
I just have to say, I thank them for not ever forgetting me. I mean, they just never have, and I hope they never do. And I try to live up to my aspects, but I'm only human, and just like they're only human. And it was a beautiful time, and I still love it because they still send me mail today. No money in pigs anymore. Canadians are flooding the market on us poor farmers. It's like a love, you know, and love is different. They never dumped me yet, so we're still in love, I guess, with the fans. I mean, to me, that's beautiful. Thank the Lord that you got what you got, and be thankful for what you have today, not, you know, what it should have been like, or if you could control it, you would have done this or done that. Then it wouldn't be life. If you could control your life, it wouldn't be life. Life has got to be mystery. That's what, you know, life is all about.
Mark Fidrich, a rare bird whose spirit still sparkles. Now let's move on to the answer of this week's Nissan quiz. Dwight Gooden of the Mets is one of the pitchers who share the record of 32 strikeouts over two straight starts. Gooden did it as a rookie in 1984. All-time strikeout leader Nolan Ryan was with California in 1974 when he struck out 32 batters over two consecutive starts. and Louis Tiant was the third, setting down 32 over 2 for the Cleveland Indians in 1968.
Power. That's what I practice for, power. And afterward, I want all the power I can get in my antiperspirant. Speed Stick.
Now, Speed Stick is improved with the most powerful wetness fighter you can buy. Nothing, but nothing fights wetness better.
The Wide Stick. Man-size protection. Saves a lot of strokes. Helps keep you drier and odor-free all day.
Now it's the most powerful you can buy. New, improved Speed Stick antiperspirant.
By Menon.
This is the Curtis Mathis camcorder, the best value anywhere.
Yep.
The only camcorder with an exclusive 4-year limited warranty on parts and labor. Plus, look at everything you'll receive free when you purchase a Curtis Mathis camcorder during May. Or check out the low sale price on this portable VCR and lightweight camera. Special financing available to qualified buyers so you can make today's special occasion a special memory for years to come. That's Curtis Mathis in Evansville and Owensboro. But hurry before those babies grow up.
See, Cowboys.
Just like everyone else, I like to save money when I buy a new car. But I also like to save money when I finance that car. That's why I go to Evansville Federal. If there's one thing I've learned, it's that checking the interest rate isn't enough. You've got to find out how the interest is computed. At Evansville Federal, it's simple. A simple interest car loan. It's less complicated and saves me money. So I save when I buy and after. It's simple at Evansville Federal.
Glorious. All the kids get the kicks, you see. At Glorious. Glorious. Well, you can rock it, you can roll it, you can even do the strolling. At Glorious. Glorious. Well, you can rock it, you can roll it, you can even do the strolling. At Glorious. Glorious. All the kids get the kicks, you see. At Glorious. Glorious. Now rock.
Good music and good times equal Glorious Corral Club. I'm Gloria, and I personally invite you to come out and join our good times.
Out? Just plain stuck with no place to go? Well, come on out to the ballpark and stick your nose into baseball's business, where sometimes big leaguers get stuck in their tracks. Careful now, you might get stuck. And talk about a sticky wicket. Looks to me like there's a load of stick-to-itiveness in both of these sticky situations. Stick to your guns, man, and stick it out. Now, here's what baseball's all about. Sticking it and picking it, or at least trying. Still sticking? Well, it's been said that anything stuck can always be unstuck. That is, if you stick around long enough and stick to a sense of humor. After all, no reason to become an old stick in the mud. From stick to slick, grand and glorious glove work, courtesy of Major League Mittmasters, starting off with a game-ending double play by the New York Mets. Wally Backman to Rafael Santana and on to Keith Hernandez. Angel Dick Schofield picks and rolls with a double dribble. Houston Astro Dickie Thon getting a good grab by Glenn Davis. The Astros again with Bill Doran doing the job. Tim Flannery, San Diego Padres. Baltimore's Juan Bonilla with the assistance of a sweet scoop by Eddie Murray. Cleveland Indian Tony Bernazar. Chicago Cub pitcher Dennis Eckersley doing it the hard way. Astro Mike Madden with an act of self-preservation. And Detroit's Larry Herndon with an act of self-sacrifice. Atlanta's Claudel Washington with a baseball ballet. New York Yankee Dave Winfield making his point. Cincinnati's Eric Davis with a skywalking routine. And finally, Kansas City's Willie Wilson over and out. Now, it's this week in baseball's 10th anniversary flashback, brought to you by Gatorade, Let's flash back to 1984. One at bat almost made Mike Heath the head case. Playing for Oakland at Yankee Stadium, Heath lined a Phil Negro knuckler right up the middle. But second base was in the way, and Willie Randolph made the play thanks to a crazy ricochet.
Anytime you can get a, you know, a line drive up the middle off of any of the Negroes, you got to be happy. So I was like a 0 for 20 at the time, and I just remember hitting a line drive up the middle, and I thought it was a base hit all the way, and it hit the bag and bounced to Willie.
Willie was way in second base over there where he normally plays. Of course, when the ball went over my head, Willie took a couple steps to the right, just his natural reaction. The ball hit the bag, and Willie stopped dead in his tracks, and the ball came right to him. He cut it chest high and threw Heath out by 10 feet at first base. I don't know if you could do that 5 more million times in baseball. Not even that many, if that would happen, but it just hit the corner in the bag. Heath could not believe it. I couldn't believe it. He started laughing. I started laughing. Randolph started laughing. Man, you got a kick out of it. And that was it. It was over. But if I look back of all really freak plays that since I've been on the mound, that's certainly going to be one of them. Because I don't think that'll ever happen again in baseball.
For Mike Heath, once was more than enough. Oh, well, that's all for now, folks. See you next week on This Week in Baseball.
Brill cream, a little dollop will do ya.
Dab.
Not this. New Brill cream mousse. A little dollop gives my hair soft, natural control all day.
Mmm.
New Brill cream men's grooming mousse.
Brill cream, a little dollop will do ya.
Why is my antacid Tums? Tums is effective. It neutralizes 1/3 more stomach acid than the other leading brand. And Tums is rich in calcium. To me, that's extra good news.
For St. Louis Cardinals baseball.
My season. With Jack Clark having become a solid first baseman and the underrated Hurd trailing only Chicago's brilliant Ryne Sandberg in fielding totals, there's no longer a weakness in the field. And there is one who's nothing short of being a wizard. He's the glue, the catalyst, a piece of the franchise, which he practically acquired in his lucrative new contract in 84. But in the case of Ozzie Smith, perhaps the premier shortstop in baseball history, he's worth every penny. After this break, we'll take you inside the life of Ozzie Smith and his family. First, let's go to Al Hrabowski with another kid's tip.
The incomparable Wizard of Oz will demonstrate the fundamentals of fielding an infield grounder.
One of my keys, and I always try and remind myself, especially when things are not going smooth for me in the field, and that does happen, is I want to get down in a good fielding position so I can move laterally both ways. And I try and feel the ball on the instep of my left foot. Always in this motion, always in this motion, always forward. And that's my fielding tip for today.
People have trust in it. It has helped secure the future for many and helped others to start over again. For countless families, it is shelter from the unexpected because they know it will be there when they need it most. It stands for affordable protection and service for your life, health, home, and car. It's the symbol of a strong, growing company and its family of agents. It's the shield of Shelter Insurance, where personal service will always be a matter of personal pride.
When the sun's real hot, the day of hard work seems to last a week.
What's the matter with you boys? It's only 102.
Bush. Head for the beer brewed natural as a mountain stream, for a taste as smooth as its name.
Bush.
Head for Bush Beer.
Head for the mountains.
The excitement's building on the greatest talent hunt in the world, the $1.5 million Star Search 86. Join host Ed McMahon and guest Gladys Knight for a fantastic hour of entertainment. It's a sensational singing, dancing, comedy showcase of surprises. A fabulous contest of fame and fortune on the showplace for the most talented new performers in America. Reach for tomorrow's stars and catch them today on the $1.5 million Star Search 86.
Tonight at 6.
Who is he? You don't know who Errol Flynn is? The movie star? Oh. Never been to a movie.
Two young men from different sides of the same neighborhood, discovering what brings them together and what threatens to tear them apart.
They arrange marriages and they arrange friends. They're complete fanatics.
A story of living, of loving, of life. Robbie Benson, Barry Miller, Rod Steiger, The Chosen.
Tuesday at 7 on TV 44.
Listen to the ovation on opening day. It won't take a meter to figure out who gets the biggest crowd reaction. It's always number one, Ozzie Smith. The Oz is a magician with the ball. His acrobatic style exudes enthusiasm and excites the fans. He plays to win and despises controversy. Don't talk to Ozzie about drugs or other player problems. He doesn't want to hear the negatives. For Ozzie, the game and his life is all positive.
To me, he's the same at home as he is with the public. He's a very giving person. You know, he's always willing to wait, and if you want him to do something, he'll pretty much go along with it. Occasionally, I have to give him a nudge or two, but he's pretty good usually.
She's that person that understands that some days when I come in, I just don't feel like talking. I don't feel like being bothered, and I just need to be by myself. And that's. That's when I think the importance of understanding what it is I do and understanding what type of person I am comes in, and she understands that.
Good, it did.
Can you do that?
Let's see, OJ.
Go.
Let's see. almost.
If my husband makes me feel like I am everything, it, at home. I've never been a public person anyway. I've never gone out and signed autographs anyway. You know, that's not something, you know, and that's not something I want to do. You know, and I'm content being Mrs. Ozzie Smith because I know I'm Denise too.
There you go. That's better.
Do you love baseball?
You know, that's really funny. People ask me that all the time, and I'm going to be totally honest with you. I really do. When I met Oz in 1978 in Houston, I was working at the Astrodome, and I was working there part-time, but I was working there because I really liked the game. I really liked baseball, and he could not believe how much I really knew about baseball.
We enjoyed doing things together. One of my favorite meals is Hamburger Helper. You know, people will think, you know, once you make a large sum of money, then all you eat is steaks and all that stuff. We enjoy doing home things. We're just common people. We're not any different from anybody else.
All right, you won because you cheated as usual, right? All right.
Ozzie's babied the shoulder much of the spring, throwing sparingly off on the side. He's played in a number of games to prevent soreness and build strength gradually. When the bell rings, though, you know Ozzie Smith will be standing at shortstop. But per club edict, and wisely so, don't look for any more season opening or ending backflips. They are just too much strain on that precious shoulder. Ozzie wasn't all defense in 85. It was his most productive season at the dish in his career. He was one of the people labeled with having a career year. Another was Tom Herr, who indeed had a career year. We'll talk about those career years, whether they can be repeated, and the difference a manager can make after Al's next instructor gives us a kid's playing tip.
The Cardinals' newest acquisition, Mike Heath, who one time hit a home run off me, has a catching tip for you.
I think blocking balls is probably the most important job a catcher should have with his pitching staff. I think whenever you get your pitcher's confidence that you can block the ball in the dirt, I think that makes him throw a better breaking ball and has a lot of confidence on the breaking ball pitches. There's a few things that I like to do whenever I'm blocking balls. Number one, the fastball is probably the most difficult ball to block in the dirt, so it's just a reaction. But number two, with the breaking pitches or the changeup, the off-speed pitches, you always anticipate that the ball will be in the dirt. So I always get a little lean going. Let's say it's a left-handed pitcher. He's going to throw his breaking ball to your left side. I always get a little lean going this way, anticipating the ball being in the dirt. So what it does is makes me come over, block the ball, put the mitt in the open zone, which you have, every catcher does. Make yourself round to keep the ball in front of you, and always tuck the chin down in this fashion right here so you don't get hit in the throat. And I think if you follow those little tips, those will help you and make you a better catcher by blocking the balls in the dirt around home plate.
Harold's the envy of the neighborhood. Let me think. Since he got his new set of wheels, a snapper lawn tractor. Sam was surprised. It had tilt steering. Carol was captivated by the powerful high vacuum action and the 12 forward speeds floored Phil.
Harold, finished?
Almost.
See the yellow pages for the snapper lawn equipment dealer nearest you. And don't forget to ask about Snap Credit.
People have trust in it. It has helped secure the future for many and helped others to start over again. For countless families, it is shelter from the unexpected because they know it will be there when they need it most. It stands for affordable protection and service for your life, health, home, and car. It's the symbol of a strong, growing company and its family of agents. It's the shield of Shelter Insurance, where personal service will always be a matter of personal pride.
There's a radio station that Evansville and the entire tri-state are talking about. It's 96STO. Let me show you why. At 96STO, we play more of your favorite music, but that's just the beginning. 96STO is giving away thousands of dollars in cash. To win your share, you tune in first thing tomorrow over breakfast or on your way to work in the car. 96STO, cash and prizes, great personalities, and more of your favorite music.
On our next edition, four stories America will never stop talking about. The sunny hideaway where Dynasty and Miami Vice stars unwind. Guess who's a 100-to-1 winner outside the diner? Rich Girl's Undercover Secrets for $20,000 an eyeful. Plus, special surprises in the city that never sleeps. A sexy romp through the delights of New England. All this and more on the next Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous.
Sunday at 8 on TV 44.
They were called career years by the media, and indeed they were timely. Now, can they be repeated? No one's totals were more stunning than Tom Herr's. Batting third in the lineup in front of slugger Jack Clark, Herr received more good pitches to hit. But oh, how he took advantage of his opportunities. The stats were dazzling. A 302 average, 180 hits, 8 homers, 110 RBIs, 97 runs scored, 31 stolen bases, all career high water marks.
Well, I said before, I'd rather be underrated than overrated. I think there's a lot of factors involved in being underrated. I think one is that I play in St. Louis, and I really don't get the media attention that maybe a player on the West Coast or on the East Coast would get. I don't feel I'm underrated by my peers. I think other players in the league and my teammates know the type of player that I am.
Herr doesn't necessarily equate improving as a ball player with statistics.
I think I'm getting better each year as far as my knowledge of the game and my knowledge of my opponents, and because of that, I should become a better player.
Some say the sudden surge in power from Herr is due to his knee surgery 2 years ago. Tommy agrees that since the rehabilitation process, he's become a better hitter.
As a result of the extensive rehabilitation, I kind of fell in love with weight training, and I was able to become stronger throughout my upper body as well as my legs, and I think the results are pretty positive. I've become a better hitter, and somebody can get an extra base hit instead of just being a slap hitter like I was when I came up. So maybe it was a blessing in disguise to go through the knee problems.
Nearly 200 runs were driven in by the third and fourth hitters in the lineup, and over 200 would have been had Jack Clark not been injured in September. Her and Clark will again be responsible for bumping the speed burners, Coleman and McGee, around the bases. A healthy Clark, and he is 100% this season, adds the one ingredient the running Redbirds have needed, a power threat. The St. Louis experience has been an indescribably happy one for Jack and his closely knit family.
Coming over your first year after being traded, it's always nice just to do some positive things or whatever, but then to actually get into the playoffs and the World Series your first year coming over, obviously that was really special, something I'll never forget, and it just made the whole transition for me and my family and everything a lot easier.
But will Clark or the city ever forget the ringing sound of his towering home run to beat the Dodgers in the National League playoffs?
Whenever I see that, I still get chills. It just is, that was the biggest hit I've ever had, and the greatest moment thrill I've had in baseball so far in my career, and I want to do it again. I want to get back and be in that position somewhere else. I wish I'd been in the World Series to help us win.
Winning the league championship and the World Series, that's what it's all about. Certainly without talented players, it won't happen. But today, the 10th man, the manager, is more important in the system than he's ever been. He must blend high-priced personalities into a team of players happy with their individual roles. He must outwit his fellow strategist in a highly refined era of specialists. It's said not only in St. Louis, but around the country, there's none better than Darrell Norman Whitey Herzog. He's won 5 divisional titles and 1 world championship between St. Louis and Kansas City since 1976. Tito Landrum, a model role player for Herzog, summarized Whitey's managing style.
You have to have rapport with the ball players, and he has just that. Like I say, you've got 25 men on the ball club, and you've almost got to be a psychologist. You've got to know the ins and outs of every ball player, and he takes time to do that. He's got his superstars, he's got his stars, and he's got his players that play, you know, but are important, do not play every day. I think it goes back to 1980 when Mike Ramsey and I were sitting on this outfield grass, and he came up to us and said, gentlemen, there are 25 men on this ball club. If I play with 24, I'm not going to make it. You guys are going to be just as important to me as the first 9 players I put on that field every day. When I call on you, you've got to be ready.
Whitey echoes those sentiments and his belief that every piece of the puzzle must fit to win.
You just can't say one thing's important on a ball club, because you got 25 people, you have to play offensively, you have to play defensively, you have to have good starting, and you have to have a good bullpen. And I don't think you can be weak in any one of those 4 areas and win a pennant.
He appreciates the regard in which he's held. And certainly the effervescent Herzog possesses what you would want in your leader, confidence in his ability to pull the right strings.
Well, I like to think that I like to be the best at everything I do, and I think that I don't want to blow my own horn or anything like that, but I enjoy managing against another good manager and matching wits and trying to do things. But basically, a manager cannot win ball games. A manager can only lose games. You cannot win ball games. You put the people in a position to win ball games for you. If those people don't produce, no matter how many moves you make or what you do, you're not going to win. So I know some guys say a manager's worth 30 games, 40 games. I like to think that a manager can lose 25 games if he doesn't handle his club correctly.
There's no better person to ask to identify the best prospects, and Whitey had the answers.
Oh, I'm impressed down here in spring training with John Morris, the young outfielder we got for Lonnie Smith. I'm really impressed with a kid by the name of Greg Matthews, a left-hand pitcher. We're going to give him a good look, and I don't like to really blow those people up where they think they got the club made, and then they're let down, they get sent back. I like to low-key it, put them out there in the competition, and if they got to go out for another year or half a year, that's just one of those things. But I think potentially they are going to be fine major leaguers.
The days melt into one another in the Florida paradise during the spring ritual. It's tiresome, tedious, and not completely necessary for the well-conditioned athlete of today. When there is a chance to slip away for a while, you'll find Whitey in a fishing boat around the golf course. We followed him to the links for some leisure time, where he teed it up with 2 local friends and the Cardinal with the longest tenure, Red Shane Dienst. Sure enough, like changing pitchers, Whitey made the right moves.
Look out. Look out. There's a four.
As the smoke cleared from the heated golf match, Whitey evaluated the Redhead's play.
Well, Red's having his troubles today. He generally plays pretty well. Every time I play with him, he seems to shoot about 75, 76. But today, he's got his baseball swing going. He's having a little trouble. But we're out here to have fun, just relax, because once the game starts, we don't get to play much golf.
With Whitey claiming a tie and the Redhead claiming foul, Red aired his views on Whitey's golf game.
Well, Whitey's been playing pretty good, you know. He's playing a lot better than he used to play. I know Larry Ziegler one time gave him a lesson about 2-3 years ago, and after the lesson was over, Whitey says to Larry, he says, "What do you think? What do you think I ought to do?" He says, "I'd take off for a week and then quit."
Sorry, Whitey. This time Red gets the last word. When we return, we'll look at what the Cards must do to repeat. It's a difficult but not impossible dream for the 85 National League champs. We'll have the media opinions, insight from the team, and a few words from Al. But first, a final Cards Kids tip.
Every aspiring youngster wants to be a good hitter. Cardinal slugger Jack Clark has these batting tips.
It sounds easy, but I get in the habit. Everybody wants to drop their bat back here and try to hit home runs. And when you don't do that, you actually will be a better hitter and hit more home runs. So you can just feel like you're bringing the bat right past your ear and getting that good solid piece right there. Your swing actually is as short as it can be. And then that, as a result, you can wait till the very last second to hit the ball. And when you can do that, it doesn't matter whether it's a right-handed, left-handed pitcher throwing you fastballs, curveballs, screwballs, spitballs, whatever. When your bat's doing that, you can wait till the last second to pick up their rotation and be quicker to get there, and as a result have increased your chances to hit the ball that time.
Look, we've got trouble in the corral.
Chasing a wayward bull's one thing, bringing him home's another.
Boy, I never seen that before.
And when you found a way to lure him back, you head for the mountain.
Bush.
Head for the beer brewed natural as a mountain stream for a taste as smooth as its name.
Bush.
Head for Bush Beer.
Head for the mountains.
This is my new Snapper rear tine tiller. It's the way to go. Look, as the wheels drive the tiller forward, the tines rotate in reverse, digging into new hard ground a lot deeper and a lot easier. Now, when I need forward tine rotation, I use my Snapper rear tine tiller for composting, cultivating, and best of all, they're both the same machine, forward or reverse. Snapper's rear tine tiller, it's the way to go.
It's a snap with Snapper.
People have trust in it. It has helped secure the future for many and helped others to start over again. For countless families, it is shelter from the unexpected because they know it will be there when they need it most. It stands for affordable protection and service for your life, health, home, and car. It's the symbol of a strong, growing company and its family of agents. It's the shield of Shelter Insurance, where personal service will always be a matter of personal pride.
Welcome to the Golden Buddha.
Yes, with warm greetings, we welcome you and invite you to taste authentic Oriental Chinese cuisine. Tempting dishes of Mandarin, Hunan, and Sichuan await you, all artfully prepared by our master chef. The Golden Buddha, given a 4-plate rating for its fine food and excellent service. Visit the Golden Buddha at Colford and Van for food that builds up our reputation.
While at the St. Louis Cardinals spring training camp, crew accommodations were provided by the Quality Inn on 54th Avenue North in St. Petersburg, Florida.
At the top of the program, I said no team has repeated in the National League since 1978. Why is it so tough?
Well, you're sort of like on a pedestal. Everybody's shooting for you, and everybody likes to beat a winner, so everybody gets up for the occasion. You know, the cream rises to the top, and having been a National League champions last year, everybody's going to be shooting for us.
I think subconsciously, you tend to relax a little bit. You don't work as hard on things that made you a good ball club before. You kind of take for granted that you're going to win instead of going out and working to win. And I think those of us who went through the transition between world champions in 82 and also Rams in 83 are going to be very conscious of that this year and try to avoid letting it happen again.
What happens if you go stale? And I think that's what happened with our ball club. Not that the talent or anything decreased. It just, things just kind of went out of kilter. You know, a few people had a few problems, and there was time for a change. And I think we started rebuilding that, and I'd like to think that this club that we have here right now is a team that we can keep together for a few years. And if we do that, then we have a real good chance of winning the National League East again and hopefully accomplishing the mission that we didn't completely finish last year, and that's winning the World Series.
This is my first year in the big league, so I'm going to try to repeat. I know that we build our defensive lineup up as long as our offense is with Mike Heath. And I know that with those guys back there, with addition to the pitching staff, even though we lost Joaquin, but we have some guys that are going to come up and fill in. You know, last year we lost Bruce Sutter, and you say, what are we going to do? But we went out and proved that we won the National League East and made it to the World Series. So you just have to sit back and see what's going to happen, and we're excited about it.
Well, the big difference is there's different faces here. We've got, I think, a younger club now, and guys are, when they're young, they're still hungry, and I think we've still got a hunger on this ball club. We've got guys like Vince Coleman, who wants to prove that he may be the best base stealer of all time. Jack Clark, I think, is a hungry type of ball player. I'm hungry, and Ozzie's the same way. Pemberton, we've got a lineup full of guys that just want to go out and play hard every day. So I don't think we'll suffer any kind of complacency like the 83 ball club did.
What do the experts say this year? NBC and KMOX Radio's Bob Costas has this analysis.
What has to happen for the Cardinals to repeat? I think that John Tudor has to win 20 again. Danny Cox has to be close behind. It's obvious that Whitey Herzog has to find, from among Tim Conroy and Ricky Horton, Kurt Kepshire, and Bob Porsche, he's got to find three guys who can go out there and win him at least a dozen games apiece to make up for the loss of Andujar. And Mike Heath has to be as much of an improvement over Darryl Porter as most people think he will be. If that happens, then the Cardinals will be there along with the Mets, and it'll be a close race again, and the Cardinals will have a chance.
The man who knows this club best, broadcasting's premier play-by-play voice, Jack Buck.
Every time Whitey talks about the ball club, he talks about Ozzie Smith and his bad shoulder that he had at the end of last year. Of course, if Ozzie Smith goes down, well, then nobody's going to pick the Cardinals to win the division, although we do have Jose Oquendo, who's a good backup man, and he's going to stay around for a long time in the spring camp until they find out just how good Ozzie Smith is. And the second thing is the pitching and the starting pitching, and we hope we can come up with enough starting pitchers so they don't disturb the bullpen and leave Lottie and Daly and Worrell and Perry out there. I think they can do that. And it revolves around a couple of people. They'll either do it or they won't. And one of them is Matthews, and the other is Conroy. If both of those pitchers make this ball club, I think the Cardinals will repeat.
Al Raboski, you've been there. What do you think of the 86 Cardinals?
Defensively, they're the best in baseball. What is a concern to me is their bench strength. If they go with a 24-man roster, they are going to have problems because they will have to come up with either a Brian Harper or a Clint Hurdle, somebody that can play five positions but does not particularly play any one of those very well. But the one thing that I'm not concerned about the Cardinals, what I saw from them in 85, their work ethics, their habits, I do not feel that they will become complacent. I think that they will be challenged. The way they lost the World Series, with the seventh game being blown out, they still have a mission to accomplish.
Do we dare ask the opposition, with so many already conceding the title to the New York Mets? Sure. Let's go to the horse's mouth and the Mets' popular announcer and ex-Cardinal great, Tim McCarver. Hey, Timmy, who's going to win, the Mets or the Cards?
If I had to choose between either team as far as their winning percentage is concerned this year, I think I would have to give the Cardinals a slight edge, even though they lost Joaquin Andujar. The Mets are vulnerable at second base and at third base as far as their right-handed hitting is concerned. However, they did get a young hitter, a right-hander, by the name of Tim Tuffle from the Minnesota Twins, and gave up only a minor leaguer, a good minor league player, and a good prospect to get him. But when you have a chance to win now, you have to win now. But the Mets have done some things to shore up their team. I don't think they were as deep as the Cardinals were last year, and for that reason, I think the acquisition of Tuffle and left-handed pitcher Bob Ojeda, will help the Mets in their elusive pursuit of the Cardinals.
About the challenge to repeat, Whitey, is it hogwash?
I don't think it's that hard to repeat. We repeated in 81 and 82, repeated three times in Kansas City. I think the American League, National League East, of course, we're so evenly balanced. There's always been a lot of good teams in the East that the team that plays the best each year wins. But right now, I mean, you know, you hear the Mets say they had the best team the last 2 years and so forth, but yet they haven't won. And nobody's really picking us to win again. We might sneak in there again. You never know.
Before we go, Whitey, are you going to sing again this year at the barbecue? Do we get another rendition of Josephine?
Old man Bush, if Gussie wants me to sing, I'm going to sing. And whatever he wants me to do, I'm going to do.
Manager Herzog and the two general managers with whom he has worked, first Joe McDonald and today Dal Maxville, have carefully constructed the team to fit the Busch Stadium mold. The record reads, 2 league championships and 1 World Series title in 5 full seasons, plus half of a sixth for Herzog's teams. That includes the remarkable 101 wins in 85. But even Whitey doubts any team in the National League East will earn 100 wins in 86. It's agreed the most improved on paper are the New York Mets with their winter acquisitions. Even destiny might be on their side as the only Eastern Division team not to win a crown in the last decade.
According to the experts, the Cardinals will likely enter the September stretch drive in a dogfight with the Mets and perhaps the Chicago Cubs. The factors involved in winning the title are complex, of course, one of which is simply the bounce of the ball. Now, some are saying, no, the Cardinals will not repeat, but Cardinal fans are saying, yes, we can. From now until October, over 2.5 million people will come through the gates here at Busch Stadium to watch the Cardinals in their quest. It will truly be a challenge to repeat.
Runnin' Redbirds, the challenge to repeat, has been sponsored by Busch Beer, the beer with a taste as smooth as its name. By Shelter Insurance, where personal service is always a matter of personal pride. By Snapper and Parker Distributing. See your local Snapper lawn equipment dealer and ask about SNAP credit. Promotional consideration to the Park Terrace Airport Hilton St. Louis, devoted to turning your business meeting opportunity into a success. This has been a presentation of SNI Sports Network, St. Louis.
Oh, no. I was sure this was the way. Maybe that way. No. I think I'm lost.
Life is full of unexpected twists and turns. So we sometimes feel lost, frightened, alone.
This Week in Baseball is brought to you by Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade is thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Right now, your body's thirsty for more than water.
Do what you want and don't anybody like you never have before. It's Gatorade, it's thirst aid. So go and give your thirsty body what it's feeling thirsty for. Quench, it's Gatorade, it's thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Gatorade Thirst Quencher quenches the thirst in your throat while it helps put back the potassium, fluids, and minerals your whole body's thirsty for.
Quench, it's Gatorade, it's thirst aid for that deep down body thirst.
Crunches.
That's why I love Nestle Crunch.
You can't run. You can't hide. It's Tipton's Yellow Tag Sale. Savings are out of control. Save 5, 10, 20, up to 40% on everything with a yellow tag. Every television and video recorder. Every appliance and microwave. And every audio component. The savings are unstoppable. It's Tipton's Yellow Tag Sale. Don't worry about finding them. Yes. Oh. They'll find you.
NEC 8-hour VHS video recorder with wireless remotes, $2.99.
I don't handle Sonny.
American League report. In New York, the Yankees hit the power switch. Yankee manager Lou Piniella sure made the right move when he called up Dan Pasqua from the minors. In his first start, Pasqua hammered a home run and drove in four against Oakland. Next day, he blasted two homers.
I just tell myself on the mental part of the game, I just told myself I have to start producing down there in order to get the opportunity back up here. And I just took it one game at a time down there, and I started hitting the ball down there, and I got the opportunity to come back.
When California came calling, the Yankees kept cranking. In game one, Mike Pagliarulo put on a power show with a pair of homers to match Pasqua's performance of the day before. But in game two, the focus turned to Yankee fielding, or the lack of it, as New York committed six errors. Costly miscue was made in the top of the ninth by Pagliarulo because it allowed the Angels to score the tying run. But Pags promptly atoned for his error in the bottom of the ninth.
Ground ball into right field. The Yankees win it 7-6. So Mike Pagliarulo, who was the GOAT 1 minute, winds up the hero.
Next day, Pags had four RBIs and New York won again. But rookie sensation Wally Joyner prevented a sweep in game four by cracking his league-leading 16th home run. A two-out, two-run job in the top of the ninth that gave the Angels an 8-7 win. Now, let's zero in on a Boston fireballer. Roger, over and out. 23-year-old Roger Clemens is still on a roll, raising his record to a spotless 8-0 with a win over Texas, a game in which Clemens carried a no-hitter through seven innings. And then, with two out in the eighth, Odubi McDowell came to bat.
There goes a liner to center. Here comes Lyons. Can't make it. It's a trap. And there goes the no-hitter.
The final nine, a complete game two hitter for Clemens, keeping the red-hot Red Sox atop the East and continuing a storybook season for a man whose career was in jeopardy after shoulder surgery last July.
I'm glad to not be pitching in pain anymore, and right now all that's behind me. You know, I had no control over an injury, and I had to make a big decision of giving up the ball last year, and I didn't want to. I'm hard-headed sometimes, and I consider myself lucky because some of the other pitchers had more serious of an injury than I did and put a lot of hard work into coming back, and it's all turned out for the best.
Clemens was at his flame-throwing best back on April 30th against Seattle when he set a new Major League strikeout record for a nine-inning game.
A new record! Clemens has set a Major League record for strikeouts in a game. 20!
Whatever achievements might lie ahead for Clemens, there's no doubt that this one was extra special.
It really was a special night, and it was just hard to believe that it happened. The game was such a hard-fought game, and it was a lot of pressure-packed innings, and watching my teammates over in the dugout, how they were going crazy, and my family was going crazy at home, and it was one of those things that I had an extremely hard fastball that night, and I was throwing it where I wanted it. Richie was moving in and out, and I was hitting his mitt. I just wasn't rearing back and throwing. I was doing a lot of good pitching, and I'm trying to keep it behind me and not let it get out of perspective.
It was one of the most exciting games, I'd say, in the top 10 that I've had in my career. I was DHing that night, so I was on the front top rail, the dugout in the ninth inning, you know, screaming and yelling and clapping and doing all kinds of crazy fun things, you know, which doesn't happen very often when you're 36 and you've played a couple thousand games in the major leagues.
I don't want to compare him to nobody because he's in a class of his own right now, because hey, this man owns 20 punch outs in a ball game.
It was an overpowering night of pitching. When you strike out 20 men out of 30 and don't allow a walk, you're doing something right and you're doing it consistently.
Clemens spells consistent with a capital K. Now let's open the notebook for this week in baseball's Twib Notes from around the American League. 33-year-old George Brett of Kansas City reached a milestone in a win over Chicago. Base hit number 2,000 of a 12-year career in which he's compiled a .316 lifetime batting average. 22-year-old pitcher Scott Bankhead made his major league debut in the game, which the Royals won 2-1 in 17 innings. Bankhead got the victory by tossing the final four innings and striking out five while allowing just two hits. The Minnesota Twins are struggling, but not for lack of power. With 76 homers in their first 46 games, the Twins had almost 20 more homers than any other team in the majors. And they're on pace to challenge the all-time mark. Led by Roger Maris and Mickey Mantle, the M&M boys, the 61 Yankees hold the record of 240 homers in one season. Now it's time for this week's quiz, brought to you by Nissan, builders of high-quality cars and trucks for over 50 years. Municipal Stadium in Cleveland was the site of the biggest crowd in the majors this season. More than 61,000 fans turned out to see the Indians defeat Toronto 3-1. But for this week's quiz, can you name the major league game that drew the largest crowd in history? Stay tuned for an honoring exhibition.
When you buy a Nissan 300ZX, you buy a legend, a tradition of many people.
In Pittsburgh, the Reds get back in the pink. You got to be lucky as well as good to win ball games, and Cincinnati combined good luck with good play to win 5 out of 6 overall, including a 3-game sweep of the Pirates. Bill Gullickson began the season by going 0-3, but in Pittsburgh, he won his 4th in a row, thereby giving credence to his manager's theory about baseball's law of averages.
Baseball has a way of getting back to the averages of a guy. If a guy has won 15, 16 games a year, unless he's injured, he's got a good chance to win 15, 16 games this year. If a guy's at 280 his whole career and he's hitting 150, he's not going to hit 150. Buddy Bell's not going to hit 160. Nick Asasi's not going to hit 180. Davey Concepcion's not a 170 hitter. Everything has a way of straightening out. And that's why it's great to have a 162-game schedule, because you don't rate someone on 15 games or 17 games. You don't rate them on 100 games. You rate them on 162 games. And I've never gotten used to losing. I don't think I ever could.
And the Reds were within arm's length of the rest of the West. Time now to turn the spotlight on San Diego's Tony Award winner. Tony Gwynn won a batting crown by hitting .351 in 1984 when the Padres went to the World Series. Last year, his numbers fell off, but this season he's back on top with a league-leading .355 average.
Yeah, I really wasn't consistent last year, but yet I wound up hitting .317, so a lot of people say, you know, the numbers are good, but, you know, my RBIs were down, my stolen bases were down, walks. Struck out more last year. When I'm consistent, I'm usually hitting the ball hard 2 times a game, spraying the ball around, not really hitting it to one place, and just being a really consistent player. That's what I strive to be. I try to be the most consistent player I can be, but, you know, in this game, with guys improving year in and year out, it becomes kind of tough.
Gwynn helps form one of the better offensive outfields in the league, along with heavy hitters Kevin McReynolds and Carmelo Martinez.
Carmelo and Kevin are power guys, and I'm the Punch and Judy of the three. You know, I spray the ball around. I don't hit many home runs, but they hit the ball out of the ballpark. So, you know, I take my razzing. You know, I'm a number two hitter, and an outfielder, a right fielder, supposed to be a guy who hits 20 home runs and drives in 100, but, you know, I'm nowhere close to those numbers year in and year out. So, you know, I know what kind of player I am, and I don't try to change from that. I try to be, you know, do what I've done to get here, and so far the results have been pretty good, but, you know, when you're getting in the clubhouse with these guys and they start talking about when you're going to hit a home run, you're like 0 for the last 100 games when you hit one. You know, it becomes kind of tough.
Gwynn recently put an end to the razzing in dramatic fashion against the Mets' Jesse Orozco, who had not given up an extra base hit to a lefty batter since 1983.
Makes contact deep, deep to right, it's out of here.
for some reason, I just thought that in that situation, he tried to sneak a fastball by me to try to get ahead of me. And I looked for a fastball inside, and I got it, and I hit it, but it broke my bat. I didn't really hit it that well, but it carried out of the ballpark. So, you know, I'm just happy that we won the game. I'm not a home run hitter, but in this case, I'll take it because, you know, it won us a ball game.
Win with win. This year's Padre campaign slogan. Now, let's review this week in baseball's TWIV notes from around the National League. San Francisco's Mike Lacoste is one key to the Giants' success so far. He gave up just 4 hits in 8 innings and got the win against Montreal to go 5-1. But Lacoste was even better at the plate, going 4-for-4 with 2 runs scored and 3 RBIs, including the game winner to keep the Giants hot on Houston's trail. For St. Louis pitcher Ray Burris, it was deja vu. He hit a second-inning 3-run double down the line for the game winner against Atlanta to go 2-0. How did Burris win his first game? With a second-inning 3-run double down the line. Now, let's line up the answer to this week's Nissan quiz. 93,103 fans packed the Los Angeles Coliseum on May 7, 1959 for Roy Campanella night. The largest crowd in Major League history turned out to see the Dodgers play the Yankees, an exhibition game honoring Brooklyn's Hall of Fame catcher who'd been tragically crippled in a car accident.
These days, Johnny Bench's bench is at the 19th hole. While my buddy finishes, I'll show you why you get a championship finish with Krylon spray paint. I'll spray this bench with Krylon, this one with the other leading brand. Krylon goes on smooth. No runs, no drips, no errors.
And it dries to the touch in 12 minutes.
1 hour later, the other brand still wins.
Yeah, time to go. What'd you shoot?
200. Hey, same as in the majors.
Yeah, what are all those flags for?
Krylon dries faster for a smooth professional finish.
On our next edition, more stories America will never stop talking about. Handsome Robert Urich and the world's most beautiful women in sunny Jamaica. Hollywood's high rollers go for broke at the $1 million World Poker Playoff. How a risque notion became a megabuck fortune out of hardly next to nothing. Plus, a galaxy of stars hop the globe from London to Malaysia. All this and more on the next Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous.
Sunday at 8 on TV 44.
There's more to jogging and walking than just keeping in shape.
You get plenty of fresh air and you see the beauty of nature. And if you're running in America's Love Run, you make your workout work harder. You'll be helping kids and adults who have muscular dystrophy and can't run. You'll be helping the Muscular Dystrophy Association help people. Also, you might see some very interesting joggers. So join me in America's Love Run. Call your nearest MDA office and sign up now.
Now!
Say hello, we've got the spirit. Say hello, come on, let's hear it. Say hello, say hello, say hello.
Make no difference where I go, you're the best place that I know. Hello, Tri-State, hello, Tri-State, TV 44.
Say hello.
Lights out? No, man, the lights were on. In Cleveland, a game against Boston. Didn't matter, though. A heavy fog made for an eerie game on an eerie night on the shores of Lake Erie. The game was stopped in the 6th so that some test fly balls could be hit to the outfield.
They're gonna have Bonds hit a pop-up and see if they can catch it.
There's a lone figure standing out in right field, and only he knows who he is. There goes one. Now, let's see where that is. I have no idea where it is. It's into the seats.
After Indians batting coach Bobby Bonds hit his fungos into the fog, the umpires decided to play ball as Cleveland fans showed signs of feeling a bit under the weather. Play was resumed, but not for long, and when the game was finally called off, the Red Sox had a 2-0 victory. But the real winner on this foggy, foggy night was Mother Nature, who brought out the bizarre in just about everybody. Hey, did I hear somebody say, play Misty for me?
We've run into all kinds of weather so far this year, and this is the first time we've run into a fog. Looks like a set from the Hound of the Baskervilles should be coming out soon.
Even old Sherlock couldn't find a clue. Time now for a wild ride at the park, brought to you by Big League Ball Handlers Extraordinaire. First up, San Francisco's Chris Brown. Boston's Wade Boggs. Texas pitcher Mitch Williams. St. Louis Cardinals' Ozzie Smith. Houston's Craig Reynolds. Another Reynolds, Harold of Seattle. John Cangelosi, Chicago White Sox. Ricky Peters, Oakland A's. Kansas City's Willie Wilson, and he gets two. Ranger Encore by Toby Harrah. The White Sox again with Bobby Bonilla. New York Yankee Dan Pasqua. And finally, Philadelphia's Jeff Stone. Now, let's get on the ball with an inside look at the Major League ringleaders. Not long after the Kansas City Royals began celebrating their world championship last October, a company began working on the players' World Series rings, a company whose employees have good reason to take special pride in their work, the L.G. Balfour Company of Attleboro, Massachusetts.
It's amazing to see the twinkle in these people's eyes, saying that, hey, I made Reggie Jackson's ring. I held Reggie Jackson's ring. I set the diamonds in Kyle Yastrzemski's ring. And they bring that home to their children, their wives, and my God, there's probably 300 or 400 people that handle a ring, and every one of those people actually believe that they took a part, and they did take a part in making that ring. It's a tremendous morale booster.
Making these rings usually costs several $1,000s apiece, and it's a precise and intricate process that involves 23 steps that can take up to a month to complete.
You create a wax mold by infusing wax into this mold. Out comes the exact ring, but made in wax. And every one of those rings are put onto this wax tree. That wax tree is put into a, let's call it a can. Plaster of Paris is filled up to the top of that can and covers the wax. Gold is poured into the top of that can and melts the wax. When the wax is melted, the gold hardens, the wax disappears, out comes a gold ring. The plaster is sprayed away or washed away, and what we have is a series of 10 or 15, 10 carat or 14 carat gold rings ready to be manufactured.
Every World Series winner since 1932 has received a ring, and Balfour has made them for 10 of the last 11. A ring means more than anything else to a man who earns one, because long after the money and glory are gone, this precious piece of jewelry still remains.
They can take everything else, but just give us that ring, because they can't take that away from us. You know, they might spend $90,000 of their winnings. They might buy, you know, a couple of Porsches, but they've always got that ring, and when they go out, they can show it off proudly that they've earned it.
I remember specifically Pete Rose, around 1975. I think the share of the World Series was about $11,000 or $12,000. And I remember him saying, I would give that money away in order to wear a championship ring. In other words, he'd pay $11,000 himself just for the right to wear a championship ring.
The real rewards in this game is not how much money you make or what kind of records you have. It is to play in a World Series and win one. And I've been able to play in six of them and win three of them. And my three prized possessions are my World Series rings.
Probably the most important thing in my life is this thing right here. Everybody on the field, coaches, managers, ball players, and even lowly umpires, get a World Series ring. And I just walk down the street today and people walk up and say, didn't you used to be Ron Luciano? I say, yeah, look, I was in a World Series.
These athletes want to be recognized off the field as well as on the field. Of course, everybody can recognize the athlete with his uniform on the field. But boy, they're so happy that they have that.
As time goes on, it'll have more and more meaning. It's simply because the memories will be there.
Well, thanks to some of the great Dodger teams that I played with and some of the great players that are in the Hall of Fame right now, we had a chance to pick up some World Championship rings, some National League pennant rings, and of course, the one that I'm most proud of right now is the one that the Balfour Company made for me, that's the Hall of Fame ring, and that's the one that I wear all the time. So my special thanks to them. I'm awfully proud of it.
Pride is something that's put into practice every day by the Major League ringleaders at the L.G. Balfour Company. Now, it's This Week in Baseball's 10th Anniversary Flashback, brought to you by Gatorade. Let's flashback to 1980. Candlestick Park in San Francisco was the site. The man, the great Willie McCovey. The moment, McCovey's last big league at bat. It came against the arch-rival Dodgers. A man on first, the score tied. It's the last of the night.
He's out there on deck, and now starts the trek up to the plate. Listen to the roar for Willie McCovey. Now he's being announced. And another roar in response to the announcement. Left-hand batter Willie McCovey facing right-hand pitcher Bobby Castillo. McCovey, the man who has hit 521 home runs in his fabulous career. Castillo's pitch. Swung on and hit in the air, the alley in right center field. A base hit going all the way to the wall. Livy's sitting around third. He's coming home. There is the relay to Lopes. No throw. And the ball game is over. The congratulations are all for McCovey. The Giants are mobbing Willie Mack. And this crowd is on its feet as one. And a salute to Willie McCovey.
During that last week of the season, I was only pinch hitting. And every time I would make an appearance, people didn't know whether that might be my last. Because as a pinch hitter, you never knew when you might come up again. So it just so happened I came off the bench that day in the bottom of the ninth inning, and I hit the double and drove in the winning run against the Dodgers. So that was probably one of my biggest hits in baseball.
Well, it so thrilled the fans that they refused to leave until McCovey came out for a curtain call.
As a matter of fact, I had already jumped in the shower. And they were still out there chanting, "We want Willie, we want Willie." So Dave Brister came in there and said, "Willie, you got to get back out there." So I put back on my uniform and went back out and took a final bow.
McCovey's next bow will be this summer for his enshrinement in the Hall of Fame. And that's all for now, folks. But see you next week on This Week in Baseball.
3 years ago, Lou Seitz.